there's a new exploit in discovered for Linux, which has got the wonderful name of Dirty Cow. As an unprivileged user, it'll enable me to get root access to the system, and then I'll be able to completely destroy it, and so on. So I'm running a Debian Linux VM. It's not limited just to Debian, basically any version of Linux that's been released over the last 10 years. What we're going to do is show that the exploit will give us a root shell, and then we can do some things that perhaps we shouldn't. So I'm going to first of all show, by trying to change the root password, that I don't have any permissions more than the normal user, so I can't change the root password. I'm now going to run the exploit. It goes and does its stuff, and boom, it's given me a root shell. And so I can now, if I move the right file back in, I can change the root password to lemonade, copy the password file back into the right place, log out of root. I'm now back at the login prompt, and I can log in as root with my password as lemonade. So I've managed to root my VM all using the Dirty Cow exploit. Well, to understand how it works, we actually need to understand a little bit about how the Linux kernel handles memory. Because what's actually happening here is we're exploiting the mechanism that Linux uses to handle its memory. And there's what's called a race condition in there that when you exploit it, enables you to overwrite files that you shouldn't normally have access to. So ones that you can read, say things like the password program or etc. password, you can read them, which is fine because you need to, but you shouldn't be able to modify them. So the first thing we need to think about is how Linux manages memory. Now, we've looked at how memory works in a computer before. What most modern operating systems, including Linux, Windows, macOS, etc. do, is that the memory that the process uses is a sort of logical address space that only exists to that process. The operating system actually thinks about it in terms of pages. These are 4K blocks of memory, which it then maps in and out as necessary. And this is how you can do virtual memory and things and pass things in and out from disk when you need it. So if you think about our program, it's got its memory address space, and we'll say it's got memory location 0 here, and then that goes up to however much it's using. Generally, you will also have other bits where the operating system is mapped in as well. So it's got its first page there, then its second page, and so on. And as far as the process is concerned, these are all continuous in memory. So that's location 0, then that's 4K later, this is 8K, 16K, 64K, and so on. So it just sees a flat memory address space which you can write into in these pages. What the operating system's doing, on the other hand, is it's thinking about the physical memory, and with the help of the CPU, it's got a translation table. So this is the logical view of the process, and this is the actual physical memory. So what happens is the operating system, well actually, when it loads the program in, it maps that one, say, into that physical page. This one may get mapped into that one. This one may get mapped into that one. They don't have to be in order. But inside the CPU, there's a translation table which is set up by the operating system when this process is in memory that says, map these pages into this location, and everything works absolutely fine. Now, one of the things you can then do is say, well, actually, say this page here has exactly the same data in it as another page in a different process. So rather than having to use two different memory locations in actual memory to have the same things, you can have them both point at the same bit of memory, and we'll have the other process off here points to the same block. And if all they ever do is read from that memory location, that's absolutely fine, because they can both read from it, they share it, there's no changes. The problem comes is, say, this process wants to modify something in that memory location. And in that case, what happens is, the Linux kernel detects that it's modifying it, so it's no longer the same between the two processes, and says, okay, I will copy this one into this page here, this physical page here, and update the translation table so we now point there. And because we've changed it, they're now pointing at two separate locations. This is what's called copy on write, because we copy it, make the copy when we write to the file, which is where we get the cow part of Dirty Cow. So that's what the copy on write does, and that process will copy the page and modify it. So what actually happens with the Dirty Cow exploit is it uses this copy on write facility, but it also does something else. As well as just being able to use the memory, because the the way Linux works, you can also map a file off disk directly into memory, and the various page faulting mechanisms that are used to handle virtual memory will then load it in when it's accessed. Because we've got access to read the file, we can write it into memory and read it. So we can read the file in, and so we'll map the file that we want to modify into, say, these memory blocks here, and these get mapped to various pages in real memory as soon as we start reading them or writing to them. So what we do is we map this file into memory, and we map it, simplifying the explanation somewhat, in such a way that it's mapped so that when it gets written to, it activates the copy on write. So we're going to make it mapped in a private fashion so that when we write to the file, we get a copy on write happening. We then do two things. We set up two threads running on the computer, one of which is repeatedly telling the operating system that we no longer need these bits of memory. So it's saying, we no longer need this bit of memory, you can page it out and use it for something else. In which case, normally you're telling it doesn't need it, so it reuses the physical memory for various things. So one of the things a computer can do, because it's got this translation table, and because it knows when you're accessing it, is take some of it, write it back out to disk, and then load something else in for another process, and then swap them in and out. This is how virtual memory works. So you can do that behind the scenes, and the operating system does that. So you're telling it you no longer need this memory, so that it's a candidate to be mapped out. So you're doing that in one thread. Then in another thread, Linux provides access to the memory as a special file on disk. And so you open that file up, and you write the new data that you wanted to go into that file to the memory locations where you'd map that file into memory. So you just write the data you want to go there. And you do these things many times a second, and eventually there's a possibility in the Linux kernel that the overlap of the two routines happens in such a way that the file gets updated and modified is changed, and so the copy on write says, oh, this has changed, but it's no longer needed, I better write this out to disk. And because this is happening as the kernel, it can write to any file regardless of permissions, so writes the updates out to disk, modifying the file that the actual program didn't have the permission to access. The result being that we can change the file on disk that we shouldn't be able to and get ourselves a root shell or whatever it is we wanted to do with it. And the reason is because the two parts of the operating system, one which is writing to the memory and the other bit which is doing the copy on write, are not sufficiently interleaved and interlocked so that they don't actually stop the thing happening. We've got what's called a race condition between the two parts.
So basically it's exploiting this race condition, so it's kind of setting two things in motion that kind of get out of sync, is that about
Yeah, pretty much. The way they're implemented is such that the two parts of the operating system, one which is writing to the memory and the other bit which is doing the copy on write, are not sufficiently interleaved and interlocked so that they don't actually stop the thing happening. We've got what's called a race condition between the two parts. I've also seen it crash the kernel when trying it as well, so it's perhaps not as easy as all that. It's a sufficiently serious bug that if you can ever get access to a shell on a system, you could probably, if it's not been patched, get up to and get a root shell and then do some real damage, install a Trojan, use it to form a botnet, whatever it is you wanted to do. So if you've got a Linux system, go and patch it, and if there isn't a patch out for it, unplug it from the network or make sure it's well firewalled. But it's a sufficiently serious bug that anything where you can get access to a root shell, it's a sufficiently serious bug, that's a tongue twister if ever there was one.